Excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sorry for the interruption, sir. Sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
Okay. How is it now, sir? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Sir, thank you, sir.
So we'll just go ahead. Yeah. So I have done close to 10 workshops in various colleges. So I also have a online course running. It's in Udemy. It's called Introduction to Embedded Systems. It is basically for students to start doing projects. So one of the main reasons for me doing this is when I was teaching, a lot of students used to go outside and buy these projects. So my main purpose was to make the students do their own projects. So I started working with students for this course, and I brought about 3.5 hours of content on this online course for the students who are attending this. They can access it for free for the next 3 days. They log in. Yeah. So I have sent the link to Prasanna and sir. Okay. So what we'll be covering in this workshop is basically how to get started. So first of all, we'll use the most basic of the board, which is the Arduino Uno board. I'll tell you what are the components required. And basically, since it's going to be a workshop on Arduino programming, we will see about digital input, digital output, analog output. So those forms like the environment on which all your projects are going to be built upon. Suppose you want to read a sensor, then it's going to be analog input. Suppose you want to read a switch, it's going to be a digital input. Suppose you want to control a motor, like you just want to turn on the motor and turn off the motor, then it's digital output. But you want to control the speed of the motor, then we come into PWM. Therefore, you have analog output. So these are the basic things you know that you can just get started and you can do your own projects. So this is your Arduino Uno board. And over here, if you see, it has a USB to computer connection. That is USB A to B cable you can use. So using this, you can download your program onto the board. The main the chip is 80 mega 328. We'll be seeing about this. On the left hand side and right hand side are pin holders where you can connect various peripherals. So I would suggest students to start with this board. This board comes up to maybe like 400 to 500 rupees. Very cheap, actually. When I was a student, I went to Ritchie Street just to get a normal development board. That time, the shopkeeper was asking me 5,000 rupees. But 10 to 15 years from now, today, the same technology is available for 500 rupees. So today, you have more opportunity to go beyond. So one of the big questions to be answered in our 4 years of engineering is a lot of emphasis is put on assembly language. But when we come to a job, when you come to industry, the more preferences is on C. Now, why is that? So on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, both the programs are the same. But on the left-hand side, in order to write the program, I need at least almost 30 lines. But the same can be accomplished in just 6 lines in using C language. But what is the trade-off? The trade-off is execution time is going to be more when you are using C language, and the amount of memory that the program will occupy in the chip memory is going to be more. So that is one of the trade-offs in when you use C. So in the industry, most of the times you will be using C. So now the question comes, when will you use assembly language? So of course, this is not connected with Arduino, but it's a good thing to know. When will you use assembly languages? Mostly assembly language is used when you have multitasking, when you have shifting between tasks. So the scheduler will be using assembly language, the scheduler, so that it can easily shift with lesser time of execution between one task to the second task. So that is where mostly assembly language is used. And remaining portion, you are going to use C language. Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir. Please, it is less audible, sir.
Okay.
So, mic, correct, that's enough, sir. Okay.
Now, the main question is, why Arduino language is preferred? So, on the left-hand side, I'm sorry, the diagram is not very clear. I'll just try to correct it. So why is there more of a preference for Arduino language? So on the left hand side and on the right hand side, you have both are the same programs trying to display on a LCD, on a 16 cross LCD, the letters M, D, E. That's all. It's a simple program. So on the left hand side, you are using 8051 microcontroller. On the right hand side, you're using the Arduino Uno board. So in order to, both are using C language, but in the Arduino Uno, already there are predefined functions. This is the very reason why Arduino is famous. Already we have predefined functions already built into the IDE. So you're just going to call those functions in order to execute the function. But when you come to 8051, you need to create your own functions. On the left hand side, if you see, you're creating your own functions over here, LCD command, LCD date, data, and then you're going to, first you're going to send the command, then you're going to send the data. Send the command, send the data. So this is a major advantage of the Arduino. Your learning curve is very, very less. Of course, with Arduino, you have lot of peripherals there. So you can do n number of projects. On the left-hand side, you have a lot of analog sensors. On the right-hand side, you have a lot of digital sensors and digital outputs also. So a lot of gas sensor, soil, moisture sensor, distance sensor, all of this are there. So for you to get started in Arduino and to do your own project, the learning curve is very, very less. So in order for you to get started, I would suggest, of course, go in with the Arduino Uno board. Currently, we are in the blue color board is called Revision 3. You'll use the A to B USB cable. You go to arduino.cc, download the program Arduino ID. For you to get started, again, breadboard, it should cost somewhere like a good breadboard should cost 120 rupees. And then you have jumper wires, male to male, male to female, female to female. So these are the jumper wires you can buy. A bunch would cost you 40 rupees. And on the left hand side, the black color board is your power supply board. So one, if you connect a DC adapter over here, you can get a 5 volt or a 3 volt output. This is not required, but in case you're going to be working with motors, this is a very good peripheral to have. Other things that you can get in the in Ritchie Street is you can get your assorted resistors. We can go in for quarter watt. Whenever you're going to be dealing with more power, that is more current is going to flow, then you can go in for half watt resistors. But in most of our conditions, we are going only going to be using quarter watt resistors. You can go in for anyone, metal, film, CRC or MFR resistors, anyone is okay. And you can go in for a few LEDs, 10 LEDs or something, and a very cheap multimeter. Other components you can use to get started are a small switch, a push switch, and on the right hand side, the blue color one is called a potentiometer. If you go to the shop and ask for a potentiometer, they'll ask you how much resistance you want. You can tell, okay, I want 1 kilo ohms or 10 kilo ohms or 100 kilo ohms. So accordingly, you get it. And on the left hand side below, you have your LDR, and on the right hand side, you have your LM35. Temperature sensor. So these are few basic components which you can just buy. The entire purchase should cost you only less than 1000 or 1500 rupees. Very cheap to get started. This I'm comparing with few years back. Now another major question would be, should I use a microcontroller or a microprocessor? You go in for a microcontroller when you just want to control things, when you want to on the motor, off the motor, control the speed of the motor. When will you go in for a microprocessor? Now, when you want to do image processing, you want to load the entire image, you want to load it onto the RAM, and then you want to apply a Gaussian filter or any sort of filter, you want to convert it to black and white. So when you want to try to do those things in hardware, that is the time you go in for a processor, microprocessor. So few of the common options are Raspberry Pi and BeagleBone. BeagleBone, you need to have a Linux background for working with it. Raspberry Pi is relatively easy to get started. Other boards that are available are TI Launchpad and ST Microelectronics, Microelectronics Nucleo board. Both have enough support on the web. You can just search for it. A lot of tutorials are there. And another important thing on why Arduino has become famous is in order for you to put a program onto the microcontroller, you need to have a programmer in between. You'll use the IDE, you'll use a program, and then you'll download it into the microcontroller. But how do you download it? It is through a bootloader, through a programmer. But in Arduino, they have written a software version of the programmer that is known as a bootloader. So the bootloader is already existent inside the chip. So this small piece of code that is only 4 KB, this small piece of code will take care of your programming needs. So what the meaning is, tomorrow, if you're going to be working with 8051, you need a separate board also to program along with it. Tomorrow, you're going to be working with a PIC microcontroller, you need to buy a programmer separate. Tomorrow, you need to go and buy an Atmel product, you need to buy a programmer separate. But because of the bootloader, you don't need a separate programmer. It has a bootloader inside, so you just need the board alone. That is one major advantage. So of course, this is what, since we are using 80Mega328, the first 32 stands for the ROM. So you have 32 KB, and out of that, 5 KB is used by the bootloader. The remaining 28 KB only you can program. 28 KB is a lot of space available. You can almost write 2000 lines of code. 2000 to 3000 lines of code can be written for 28 KB. Of course, that also depends upon the data you are passing. If you want to get started in Wi-Fi or Bluetooth projects, I would suggest ESP32. It also runs, it can be run using the Arduino IDE. So you use the Arduino IDE along with the ESP32, and then you can do Wi-Fi and Bluetooth projects. So what are Wi-Fi and Bluetooth projects? That is nothing but your IoT. So here, these are the three sections. On the left-hand side, you have the edge devices. In the middle, you have your where you send your data to the cloud. And on the right-hand side, you have your services. So this is your IoT. You'll be majorly working on the left-hand side column. Now let's get started with the Arduino Uno programming. So this is the workshop. This is the course I have running. I have sent the link to Prasannan sir. If any students are interested in doing it, please use this coupon code and just enter it. It will become free. Almost 1,000 students have already used this course. Now, this is your Arduino IDE. So on the top hand side, you have your button. In the center, you have where you enter your program. And below, it shows if there is any error or if you have downloaded successfully. So the basic structure of the program is you have a void setup and void loop. So it is inside these two functions that you have to write your program. So it is it's same like this is a modified version of C. So we write everything inside void main. So they have modified this, and for the Arduino IDE, you need to write it inside void setup and void loop. Anything you write it inside void setup, it will run once. Anything you write inside void loop, it will run repeatedly. So suppose you want to initialize a pin, you will put the code under void setup. But you want to turn on an LED on and off continuously. You want to turn on and off a motor continuously, or you want to monitor the temperature every 10 seconds. Then you will be writing it inside void loop. So this is the basic structure of Arduino programming. Any Arduino board you take, it's going to be this one. Even the ESP32, currently we are running in version 3, even in ESP32. ESP32 is also a very good board to get started. It's only about 700 rupees. You can do IoT projects very easily. Now, coming back to this, we have void setup and void loop. So, of course, always add comments. It's a very good proper way of programming. Today you add comments, you open it 1 month from now, you will know what are the inputs, what are the outputs, who modified the program, what is the program doing. Always include comments in your program. So you have your RAM, ROM. So 80Mega328 means you have 32 kilobytes of ROM and 2 kilobytes of RAM. Okay, so let us go into digital output. So So what is the digital? I'm sorry, the below one is wrong here. What is a digital output? A digital output is when you want to give 5 volt or 0. Or in certain microcontrollers, it is going to be 3.3 volt or 0. You can also go as far as 1.2 volt and 0. That is your low power microcontrollers. So digital output is 5 volt or 0. So 5 volt means on, 0 volt means off. So initially, we need to tell whether the pin is going to be output or input. So first we need to tell pin mode 13, output. That means I'm initializing pin number 13 as output. Now in 8051, we would have studied it as port 1, port 2, port 3, port 4. They are not using this. They are using a more abstract version so that it's more simplified. So you have only pins 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up to 13. You don't have P1, P2. It is there, but they have applied a level of abstraction. So now we have pin mode 13, output. If I put pin mode 13, input, that particular pin will start acting as a input. So pin mode 10, output means that particular pin will start acting as a output. Now, if I want to produce a 5 volt, I will do digital write 13, high. So that at pin number 13, I'll get 5 volt. If I do digital capital W write 13, low at pin number 13, I'll get 0 volt. Another function that I can use is delay. So delay 2500 means it will be delayed 2500 milliseconds or 2.5 seconds. So if I have digital write 13, high, delay digital write 13, low, and if I connect a LED to pin number 13, that pin number 13, the LED will turn on for 2.5 seconds and then off. That is it. The same program, if I put it in void setup, it will be executed once. And if I put it in void loop, it will be executed repeatedly. So every 2.5 seconds, it will turn on, turn off, turn on, turn off. So it depends upon where you put the delay and how many delays you use. Okay. So these are the different types of LEDs available. I cannot talk only about programming because embedded systems is hardware plus software. So these are the different types of LED. It depends upon the shape and it depends upon the size also. So the minute you go to the shop, they'll ask you, what LED do you want? So first of all, you have to tell what size, 10 mm, 5 mm, 3 mm LED. So what you see over in the page currently is 10 mm. 5 mm and 3 mm LEDs. Next, you have to tell whether you want a diffused LED or a non-diffused or a proper LED or a clear LED. I'm sorry, the word is clear or diffused LED. So this is the difference between diffused and clear. So in diffuse, the case will be a more diffused. It will spread out the light. But in clear, you can only see the light on top of the LED. These are your SMD power LEDs. This is your SMD LEDs. And these are your RGB LEDs, that is your 3-pin and 4-pin LEDs. So now let us see how to control a LED. So if you are going to connect 5 volt directly to LED, only one thing will happen. It is going to burn off. The LED is going to give a sudden brightness and then sudden light and then it's going to burn off. So you cannot connect 5 volt directly to a LED. So what you need to do is, Arduino Uno output is 5 volt 40 milliamps, but a LED can only take 2 volt 20 milliamps. So you need to have a resistor in between. So you need to apply Ohm's law. Yeah, I'm not going to get into it because it will take more time. So you need to calculate the value of resistance. It will be calculated as 150 ohms, and then you need to connect this. So I have connected to pin number 13 and through that I have connected the resistance and then the LED and then the ground. So if I'm going to write a program to turn on a LED, first I need to initialize the pin as output and then I need to tell, okay, digital write pin number, high. So first I tell inside void setup, I'm going to initialize pin mode 8 comma output. 8 is where my LED is going to be connected. Void loop, digital write, 8 comma high. This will produce a 5 volt at pin number 8. So once I give this connection, I need to come over here and then write this code and download this code. Now, both these programs are going to be doing the same thing, but here it's going to be continuously sending out 5 volt. Here, it's only going to be doing it once. Now, there's a small difference in the previous program and next one. Here, I'm going to blink LED. So what I'm going to do is, first I'm going to initialize the LED as output. Next, of course, you cannot initialize it as input because you're going to output 5 volt. If you're going to read it, if you're going to read a sensor, you're going to be doing pin mode 8 comma input. Next, in void loop, what you're going to do is first is turn on. So 8 comma high, call a small delay of 1 second, then digital write 8 comma low. So you're going to turn off and delay of 1 second. So what is going to happen in once it's going to initialize, then once it comes into void loop, first turn on the LED, wait 1 second, then turn off the LED, wait 1 second. And again, since it's void loop, again, it'll go to the starting of void loop. It will not go to void setup. Again, it will come here, turn on, wait 1 second, turn off, wait 1 second. So LED on, wait 1 second, LED off, wait 1 second, LED on. So this is how it works. So this is the basics. Now, the structure of programming is going to be the same in whatever platform you choose. Tomorrow you're going to use a microprocessor Raspberry Pi. The connection is going to be the same. If you see this connection and the previous connection, the connection is the same. The programming is also going to be same. First, initialize the pin, turn on, wait, turn off, turn on, turn off. Of course, the structure and the method in which you do is going to be different. But the structure is going to be the same regardless of any platform you choose. Let us look at one more example where you're going to be using Atmel. Here also same thing. First, you're going to make the pin as output, then turn on the LED, wait 1 second, turn off the LED, wait 1 second. So regardless of the platform, the structure is going to be the same. So once you understand the structure, you can go into any platform and work. Of course, you need to know to write your own functions. So now we have looked at digital output. What is digital output? Turning on a LED, turn off a LED. Oning a motor, offing a, not oning, sorry, on a motor, off a motor. On a fan, off a fan. You cannot connect a microcontroller directly to a motor. You need a driver in between. So you're going to turn on, turn off. Okay, next is analog output. So this is what we just saw, digital output. Analog output is where I can slowly ramp up the voltage. So using analog output, I can control the brightness of the LED. So I can control the brightness of the LED. So for this, it depends upon my duty cycle. We would have studied in the second year. So if I control the duty cycle of my pulse, the brightness of my LED is also controlled. Higher duty cycle will give me maximum brightness. Lower duty cycle will give me lower brightness. So how does it correspond? Where can I use it? Controlling the speed of a motor. It's as simple as that. Higher the duty cycle, the speed of the motor will be maximum. Lower the duty cycle, the speed of the motor will be minimum. So this is how, as I vary my PWM signal, I can control my motor speed or LED brightness. So this PWM output, this and all we saw. So how do I use it? I'm going to use analog write pin comma value. So I'm going to do analog write. So it's an 8-bit register. So 8-bit means 2 power 8. That is going to be 0 to 255. So if I give 255, I'm going to get 5 volt output. If I give 128, I'm going to get 2.5 volt output. Like that, 0 to 255, as I vary the value, the output will also vary. Only certain pins I can use for this. That pins that are 3, 5, 6, 9, 10, and 11. So what I'm going to do is analog write, select my pin number. Okay, 3, 255. It's going to have the maximum speed. Analog write, 3, 128 means it's going to run at 50% speed. analog write for 25% speed. So I can write a for loop to vary the value from 0 to 255. So slowly the brightness will increase from minimum to maximum. So that is your analog write. I'm just running through this. So next one is my digital input. What is a digital input? I need to either know whether a switch is closed or open. Or in another sense, if I'm going to talk, I need to know whether a 5 volt is applied or 0 volt is applied.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sorry, sir. Small reminder, sir. Time is 6:33, sir.
Thank you. So, digital input means the microcontroller is going to read the input. It can either be 5 volt or 0 volt. So, first question comes, how do I connect a switch to a microcontroller? So, the first thing that comes is connect the switch directly to a 5 volt. If I close the switch, a high comes and I know high is there. If I open the switch, I don't read anything, and then we can know that it is 0 volt. Similarly, if I ground it, if the switch is open, there's no connection, it's going to be 0 volt. And if I close the switch, it's going to be connected to 0 volt and it's going to be low. But there is a huge problem over here. So one of the things is, if I connect a switch and if I press the switch, it's going to be connected to 5 volt and it's going to be high. But when the switch is open, the microcontroller does not know what is the value, because everything has to be closed at all times. You cannot have an open loop in a circuit. So how do I bring a solution to this? So my question is, I can have a switch. I can connect it to 5 volt. If I press the switch, 5 volt is connected. But when the switch is not pressed, that is when the switch is open, I need to make sure opposite of 5 volt is 0 volt. Opposite of high is low. I need to make sure low or ground is connected to input. So I need to pull the circuit low. So what I need to do is, so one of the solution is I can connect a ground, but of course we know that this will not work. 5 volt and ground cannot be connected. Your power supply will burn off. Another solution is we can connect the ground after the switch. This, first of all, it will damage once the switch is pressed, or it will permanently be grounded. So the solution is to use a pull down resistor. So when the switch is open, the input pin will be pulled down to ground. But when the switch is closed, current will always take the least resistant path and ignore this particular path. That's Ohm's law, right? We studied. So it will always choose the least resistant path. A switch offers a least resistant path to 5 volt. So current will only flow in this particular path. So either you use a pull up or pull down resistor. Similar thing, if you're going to be using a ground, you're going to need a pull up resistor. So just coming back to what we are doing is, we are going to read a digital value, that is digital input. Previously we saw digital output, so we saw digital write, we saw analog write, and now we are going to see digital read. How can we read a digital input? So first I need to initialize the pin as input, and then I need to give variable is equal to digital read comma pin number. Now why I need to do this is, once I'm reading a value, I need to put it into a variable. So digital read, I need to tell the pin number. So if I'm going to read from pin number 10, digital read 10 is equal to a variable value. Let us put it as S. So S is equal to digital read 10. So once I read that value, it will be available in the variable S. So it will be either high or low. Now, so this is how you have it. So A is equal to digital read 5. Of course, before you do this, you need to initialize it as input. So this is how you use. There are different types of switches available in the market. This is more theoretical. These are the different types of switches. The left hand side is breadboardable, and the other ones is where you use in your boards, that your PLC boards, no? So those type of boards. So these are also various switches you can use. This on the right hand side bottom corner, the blue color one is known as your contact switch. So the minute anything comes and hits it, so it will know that the switch is closed. So a switch has four pins. If you see over here, it has four pins, but here it is only depicted as two pins, right? So what is the remaining? So what about the remaining two more pins? So out of the total four pins, two pins are going to be common. So one and four are going to be common. That is, opposite sides are going to be common. Two and three are going to be common. So these are known as push buttons. Yeah. So this is how a very simple circuit you can do. You're going to have a switch connected to pin number 10 through a pull up resistor and a LED connected. So if I press the switch, I need to write a program to turn on the LED at pin number 4. For the purpose of this resistor is, I should not connect a resistor directly to a Arduino Uno board. So this is how it will look in the Arduino, this will how you it will look in the breadboard. So how will I write the program? So first, in void setup, I'll first declare the pin which is connected to the LED as output, the pin which is connected to the switch as input. So I'll enter into void loop. First, I will read the state of the switch, store it in a variable, and then according to the variable value, I will either turn on or off. If the switch is pressed, I will turn on the LED. If the switch is not pressed, I will turn off the LED. It is simple. It's a very simple programming. So it takes only a few number of lines. Let us see 1, 2, 3. Less than 10 number of lines, you can do a very, very small thing. Now, so what is the application of this? By pressing a switch, you can do some other process. By pressing a switch, you can control a motor. By pressing a switch, you can turn on the light. By pressing a switch, you can turn off the light. So very simply, you can do a lot, n number of projects.
Sir, actually the time is 6:40, sir.
Want me to stop or continue for 5 minutes?
Okay, sir.
What do you want me to do, sir? Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yes, yeah, now I can hear you, sir.
Yeah, now the time is 6:40, sir. Actually, we have a next event on 7 p.m. So, shall we end the session or what, sir? So, I'm not getting your voice, sir.
If the students are interested, the same thing, I have put it as 3.5 hours of content. It is available in Udemy. You can access it for free. Yeah. So it's this coupon is available only for 3 days. Please use it. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Sorry for this happening, sir. Okay. So I will invite Mohan, sir, to give a vote of thanks.
Okay. Good evening, one and all present here. I thank to our management, our beloved principal, our HOD of EC, Dr. Komala James, to conduct such a good event to share the knowledge to the student. I extend the thanks to our department staff to support for the conduction of this program. And I thank to the student, and I thank to the Sham Thomas. Mr. Sham Thomas is sharing the very good knowledge for the Arduino board for initiator. Initiator initiation for the program and developed for the system. He is given the knowledge for the student how to assemble language to write the Arduino board and how to generate the program project and how to write the program in the editor. And one more thing, he is given the very good thing to develop the project like a switch and a LED connection. This is going to useful for our student to develop for the embedded system. It's like a sensor reading and writing, all the things. Okay. Thank you to all. Thank you, Sam sir. You are going to given the time to share our your knowledge, your busy schedule to share knowledge to our student. Thank you, sir. Thank you all. Thank you, Prasanna sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you
so much, Sam sir. Thank you, sir. Dear participants, now I will share the feedback link through our screen. Okay, because the chat box is not enabled here, so I will share the screen now. Please make a note of it. And also, I will share the link to the WhatsApp group through the class advisor also. So please submit your feedback form. Okay, so e-certificates will be provided for the participants who are submitting the form. Okay, so I will share the screen now. Okay, Sam sir, yes. Please unshare your screen, sir. Yeah, okay, sir.
Shall I log off?
Thank you, sir. Yeah, yes, now.
Yeah. Please.
So is it visible to everyone?
Student? Hello?
Sir, please.
No, sir.
In
yes.
Okay. So I will read the links. Please make a note of it. Okay. HTTPS. Okay, double colon. Sorry. HTTPS colon double slash. Okay, forms. FORMS forms dot office dot com. Okay, forms dot office dot com slash R for rabbit R slash capital J. Okay, small Z capital P for parrot capital P small S capital B for ball capital B small a and then 112 u for umbrella small u. Okay, this is the link. Okay, I will also share through the WhatsApp group also. Okay, please submit your feedback form. So I think now it is visible for everyone, right? Is it visible, Ba?
Sir, screen visible ah irukke but font size romba chinna da irukke sir.
Okay sir. Okay sir, na WhatsApp group la send pannirren sir, pa students group la send pannirren.
Okay sir.
Next event time irukla. Okay sir. Okay, thank you all for your participation. So I will share the course link to the WhatsApp group. Please share this content to all your friends. Okay, thank you all. Thank you, sir. Shall we end the meeting now?
Thank you, Prasanna sir. Thank you, Mohan sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. So I'll end the meeting now,
Prasanna.
Sir.
Yeah, end Prasanna and end pannidu.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thanks. So because of the event, vegama mudikiram da. Okay. Thank you
all.